Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here. How's everybody doing?
I hope you're good. I am great. Time for another garden tour.
I figure may as well start off where I left off in my last vlog, which is the veggie garden. Thing is how this has only been planted up for a few days, so it's not going to be many differences in here from that vlog, but it wasn't in the last garden tour because it didn't exist yet. So some of the jalapenos are fully ripe. Need to get those off when they're red. They're a little bit sweeter, slightly less spicy. So I typically pick them when they're green, but sometimes I let some of them go red also. Then even though it's only been a couple of days, got some new growth coming out on those Scotch bonnets, which had to get a very heavy pruning. They're looking good. Bell peppers already have new growth coming out of them. Pardon all the snail damage. If you didn't see the last vlog, the snails have just been terrible this year. But it's all good news with the peppers. New growth coming out of all of them. And same thing with the amazel basil that's over here. This basil smells so good. I can smell it from fairly far away. Then all the strawberries that are down here, those buried treasure strawberries from Proven Winners, are doing their thing, you know, being strawberries. Oh, my fingers smell like pizza sauce or pizza. It's so much basil. Since I'm over here, don't want to forget to talk about the carnivorous plants. This was done in a vlog, back in May. Filled it with a whole bunch of sarracenias. They are doing wonderfully. Lots of growth coming out of this one. Haven't had any issues with it. I've had to pull some dead growth out, but it's like just old growth, nothing serious. Not like anything's going wrong with it. Trying to be very careful here. Holding my camera over the water isn't like my favorite thing to do. Better view of the taller pitchers that are in there. And these, none of them had names on them, so I don't like to give them names if I don't have the tags, because there are a lot of varieties that look very, very similar. But they're cute. That's all that matters. They're pretty. They should all be hardy to my zone, so they should overwinter just fine. I'm not worried about that. The water is intentionally green. It's green water. That's on purpose. It's not dirty. Back here, the windmill palm. This got pot up in a vlog a while ago when I was on the hunt for those brown pots. Impatiens are filling out very nicely in there. I think it could use a little bit more sun, so I may end up relocating that because the sun's changed. It's summer now. Coleus looking good over here. This is a planter I did with my pygmy date palm, my Robolini. That's right here, the Phoenix Robolini. I put some caladiums in here, two of these white ones, and when I did that video, I was really nervous that maybe it was a bad fit just because I was really unsure about the amount of light that they would be getting over here. But they're doing great. I haven't had any issues with them scorching or anything, and they're getting along, as far, you know, getting along. They've paired up fine with the Cortland fruticosa that's in here. This is the Harlequin, and the one in the back, I believe, is Red Sister. And have that gorgeous pink dragon's wing begonia coming over the front. The Supertunia Vista Silverberry hasn't done much. None of the Supertunias really have, except for the ones around the pool. I'm thinking that that's a precipitation thing. I'll talk about that in a minute when I show some of the other ones. This is that croton that got smashed by the palm tree that fell on top of it. And it's rebounding well. It's got lots of new growth coming out the top. It's doing okay. I think I'm just about ready to swap this out with my monstera, the Thai constellation, my variegated monstera. That normally goes here, but I've been kind of waiting for the sun to finish shifting so the spot isn't quite as intense with sunlight. I think I'm just about there. Just about there as far as the time of the year goes, that is. And then back here, my dog knocked over that caladium right before I started filming, so that was nice of him. Say thanks, Toby. Those caladiums are doing great. The dracania's doing well. The impatiens that I planted back here underneath this alpinia are starting to flower and look nice. And the bromeliads still doing their thing. Still looking pretty. No changes there. No change, good thing. Macho ferns putting on a lot of growth, getting very big. There are two macho ferns over here, and I think I'm gonna have to move them eventually, right? They can get up to 6 feet tall, so probably not gonna work out. Mostly just this one. It's kind of blocking light from the things behind it. So that's the one that I think I'm gonna need to pull that out eventually. The dracania down here, that is a dracania reflexa from a video, a few weeks ago. Doing real well. It's actually put out a lot of new growth, so that's nice. Exciting, love new growth. This is my foot. That video hasn't come out yet. Don't worry about it, pretend you didn't see that. No foot there. New leaf on the bird of paradise, actually just about multiple leaves. That one's getting ready to open up a few. Opened one up not too long ago. These planters, fairly similar to the ones over there with the Cortland fruticosa. This is definitely a Red Sister, pink dragon's wing begonia. And then I have the Supertunia Vista bubblegums in the front of these pots as well. And like I said, not doing what I had hoped they would be doing. It rained like all of June, just so much rain. a lot of people's petunias ended up dying and melting, so I got lucky that they held on through that, but they just kind of have somewhat sat still. And there's not a ton of light over here either, which is fine. I've planted the Vista bubblegum in shady locations before, and it did well. It's just the flowers were a little bit more sparse. It still flowered, just was a little bit leggy. And I was like, you know what? I'm okay with that. Having petunias in a shady spot, you can't do that with most petunias. So I kind of thought that might be an issue up here in the front. So it's either the light, the rain, or any combination of the above. They're still growing though. Alocasia lutea. These were just divisions that I put in here underneath this Adenidia palm not that long ago. I don't know, May, so a couple months. Late May, early June, and their roots have set out and they're growing very well, having a great time. In fact, I can probably go ahead and get this. I had left this leaf on here. I haven't cut it off yet because it still had some green in it, so it was still providing energy to the plant, and I want it to keep putting up new foliage, but I'm pretty sure once that leaf right there opens up, I can go ahead and cut this off finally. It doesn't need it anymore. And I had also back here planted the Alpinia zaremba variegata, the variegated shell ginger, and that was just a division. It's put up a whole bunch of new growth. It's not super evident. I'm hopeful within the end of this month, so hopefully you'll be able to see that in the August garden tour, there'll be a small wall of those variegated leaves back here. I think that'll look nice. I've talked about it in a lot of my videos. I like having the contrast and veining, variegation, any type of lightness that I can get, because at nighttime it lights up, it illuminates, it draws the eyes back, particularly like these caladiums that are back here, and then the white caladiums that are over here in this pot. That's just, they light up. They're so pretty, they're reflective, they brighten the area. That's what I've been hoping they would do, and they did it. Speaking of reflective, look at this Exora. Oh, she's bright. This one doesn't have a name to it. It was just an assorted Exora I picked up from a big box store, probably Lowe's. I got it back in April. It had just come off the truck, and I kind of just reached back and took it off a rack who's hiding behind plastic and stuff. It's blooming, doing fantastic. I gave it a little bit of holly tone, a little bit of acid, and it seemed to like that. And it's been a pretty much a fuss-free plant. Exoras are usually pretty stuff. Exoras are usually pretty tough. And over here, we got my little sea of heliconias that are mostly waiting to be planted up. I planted up a few, which I don't think any of those videos are out yet, but I have planted some up. They're doing well. These were all in my suitcase just a couple weeks ago, coming up from Florida. Did well. They had a good trip. I was surprised how well they did. They didn't really have any damage to them. They're still blooming great. Looking good. The Andromeda heliconia that's in the front has some new stuff coming up on it down there and over there behind that bloom. And then the lady dye heliconias, they're just always blooming. They're always happy. Oh, and this bird of paradise in this pot, it's been growing very well. Been throwing up new leaves like seemingly constantly. It's put up at least 4 or 5, which means I can probably go ahead. I think I can cut that one out now. It's been bugging me for a while. And come through, trim that out now that it's got a bunch of new foliage on it to take in some light. Because yeah, see that? That looks dumb. Also, why is that leaf pointing this direction? What are you doing? Don't you know my aesthetic? Didn't you get the memo? You're supposed to be fanning out, not coming at everything. That's dumb. Why'd you do that? It looks so stupid. Whatever, it's doing that because I guess that's the direction it seems to think the light is, even though the other ones aren't doing. Why? Why? Oh, that's really gonna bug me. It's fine for now. Moving on. The epidendrum over here. This is the epidendrum radicans, the ground orchid. Doing great, always doing great. It's a really sturdy plant. They just flower and flower, put off new offshoots. They don't usually skip a beat. They're happy plants, easy to grow orchids. Needle palms, doing their thing. Hopefully those are gonna get planted up sometime this week or next week, which I'm very much looking forward to. And this is the lantana tree from the lantana tree video. The variety was confetti, still is confetti. It's just the flowers have faded to being all pink now, so they don't have those yellow circles on the outside. A little bit of yellow left in the middle, but otherwise pretty much just pink. So once this bloom cycle is done, I'm gonna give this a very heavy pruning. It could use it. You can see how the plant's starting to split, sort of, it's starting to flop. So that's when I wanna give it a cut and get it to thicken out. And the hydrangea's getting ready to bloom. I was really hoping this would be in bloom in time for the July garden tour, but no luck. By the time this video comes out, it's gonna be like the 8th or the 9th. Oh, don't fall in the pool. And I prefer for the garden tours to be out between the 1st and the 5th, so already late on that one. If I keep waiting, then this video wouldn't be out till the middle of the month. So I'll have updates posted on my social media with all that, and I'll, at the end of the video, I'll talk about that.
I keep coming in here and pulling this honeysuckle out. This is the major wheeler, which is planted back here, and on this side, I did finally find a garden arch. I've been trying to find a garden arch that I could put over the staircase to get that honeysuckle to grow up. The problem is this is just over 8 feet from the outside to the outside, and it's because it has to go out a little bit further over here, and that's because there's a bunch of gravel and cement where you can't really get anything into the ground there. So where I can get it goes 8 feet across, and it's hard to find a garden arch that big. Now, Garden Answers, Laura, I just saw her post a video not too long ago. She got some massive, humongous garden arches, and they look really pretty. I don't think I'm going to be able to go that route, but I found some other ones for like $25 on Amazon. I'm sure they're not very sturdy, but I might give it a whirl, see how long they last. So that way this honeysuckle will grow up and over that arch instead of trying to grow into the hydrangea trees, because the hydrangea trees don't need that. I mean, look at that, growing all over the top. It's not necessary. Here are those windmill palm pots that was from a vlog not too long ago. This sweet potato vine, I think the variety was called Bewitched, maybe? I can't remember. It's very bushy, way more full than I expected it to be. That's not really working for me. I might have to pull those out just because it's really encroaching on those impatiens. It doesn't need to be that full. You know what I mean? False aurelia's got lots of new growth coming out the top. This has been a sturdy plant. I haven't had to do anything with it. This whole area is getting redone in this weekend's vlog, so stay posted for that. Stay tuned for that. New growth coming up here out of the plumeria. I can go ahead and move this, actually. They need full sun. I've been acclimating it, and I think it should be ready to go out into the sun. When I brought it outside, that's embarrassing. You didn't see that. The foliage started to scorch out, even though I had acclimated it. But it should be good now. So I can go ahead and get this moved. And what's real exciting, look at the monstera. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 leaves. This has opened 3 leaves since I brought it outside. This one in the back being the newest that just popped open. It's very, very happy out here. I think it enjoyed being repotted this winter. Lots of new growth. The variegation's not super heavy on it, but I'm okay with that. Every leaf that comes out looks a little bit different. That's part of the fun with this plant, right? Tiny green foliage and so much growth. Such a happy plant. Getting really tall. That's probably... it's close to 4.5 feet tall. It's really getting up there. The mimosa's asleep, so I'm not really gonna be able to show you how that looks, unfortunately. Actually, I need to do part of this video of the front yard in a couple days, like hours before I release the video, so I can get a shot of the mimosa tree then. Back here, philodendron by Panadifidum, looking good. Threw a bit of a fit when I brought it outside, which is kind of unusual, but it's bounced back, recovered. It's forgiven me for bringing it outside and giving it more water and nutrition. I don't know what that was about. Usually it's fine with coming outside and it like celebrates and grows like crazy. Speaking of growing like crazy, look at how big the leaves are on this pedicis. This is Pedicis japonicus gigantea, I believe is the variety. These are absolutely massive. These leaves are huge. I don't have my tripod or a camera person, but just look. So big. These are humongous leaves. That's not even one of the bigger leaves either. They do have some hail damage and some snail damage. The snails have been, man, they've been driving me crazy this year. I can't wait for the product. I ordered some of the bone-eyed slug and snail stuff. I love that product, but I haven't been able to find it anywhere. Everybody's sold out because the snails have been a big problem for a lot of people around here because it rained all of June, so that's not surprising at all. But because of that, yeah, just waiting for the product to come in. I've been using some other stuff to keep things at bay while I can. The other pedicets that are in here are just the variegated ones. They're okay, a little bit thirsty. I don't know why, because I thought the sprinklers should have hit them. Maybe I need to adjust my drip. As the foliage on things grows, I use micro sprayers back here. As the foliage starts to get beefier on the plant, sometimes leaves block them and stuff like that. So that's something I'll check that out in a little bit. Majesty palms, because of the majesty palm video, they're here still being majesty palms. Here I have some other majesty palms that are doing their thing. That video hasn't come out yet, so I don't know why I'm showing it to you. I really shouldn't be. I have a few planter videos that I've been working on where I'm letting them grow out and fill out for a few weeks before I finish the video, because that kind of helps, I think, give a better impression of what it looks like when you don't
pack the pot full right when you get it, because that's not always practical. That can be very expensive to do, right? So that's what's going on there. The supertunias doing well. Not as much growth on this end as on the other end, but these were also planted like a couple weeks later than the other ones. So let's go look at the other ones.
I say let's. What I mean is let me go show you. How about them petunias? Oh, they're big. And this sweet potato vine, you guys, it's too much. When I potted this up, I was saying, I had explained the issues in the past with the sweet potato vines was that they were just too vigorous and they choked out the supertunias. So I tried a different variety this year, one I tried last year that wasn't as vigorous, but it wasn't also getting as much light as over here. And this is just as vigorous, very full, very bushy. I have to come in here just about every single day. I come in here and I grab the stragglers and pull them to the sides like so, and so it keeps growing in its own direction. That's just too much work for me. I know that doesn't sound like a big deal, but there's a lot of other plants out here that need my attention. So like being able to cut corners and not have to guide my sweet potato vines is a nifty thing. So I don't know if I'm gonna keep them. I think it might look just as great to just not have those and have the super tunias all the way around the pots, and it might look even better. Maybe I could throw the silverberries in the spot so it's like pink and white and pink and white, or I would really like to do the purple wave petunias. But for some reason it feels kind of like sacrilege, like I'm not supposed to combine the super petunias and the wave petunias together. Like maybe they won't get along, they're competitors, you know what I'm saying? No, I know, I'm just being stupid, that's not necessary. More weeds, always weeds. It's a constant struggle. Yeah, look at how big and full these have gotten. So much growth on them. And this one I've been able to keep growing a little bit more like along a narrow path, I guess is what you would say. And you can see the super tunas are responding well to that. They're kind of spreading out, doing well. As long as each plant gets their quarter, I think it'll be okay. The main thing is that I just can't let these potato vines, what they did last year is they firecrackers, hopefully. They shoot out, they run across, and when they do that, they put their little roots down, and that's when they start to choke things out. So I'm mostly just kind of trying to keep things open in here, which isn't that hard to do. Please excuse the fireworks. I don't know what that's about. They're not even legal here, so that really shouldn't be going on. I'm sure my dogs really appreciate that. Over here, Chinese fan palm, doing well. The Iconia begonia, I had been concerned about it maybe not doing so great once the heat of the summer kicked in, and yeah, it's not doing fantastic. Worst case scenario, I pull that out and pop a pink sun impatient in there. That'll work out just fine. But right now it's throwing a little bit of a fit because we went from being in like the 70s and 80s and constant rain outside to just 95 degrees and dry. So they don't like that. That wasn't a great transition for them. Nobody, I didn't enjoy it either. It's like, where was spring? What happened? It's just hot now. Remember all those caladium tubers that got planted in here? That was in the video right before the last garden tour. It's only been about 3 weeks. Look at this. So much growth. I need to actually probably pull these out before they start to set root too much. But the spot where they might be going isn't ready in the front. I'm still waiting for that stump to get ground out, which is supposed to happen Tuesday morning, which should be the morning this video comes out. So hopefully they'll get here and get that done so I can finish the video and release it. I don't think I'm gonna be able to plant these the same day though, because I need to pick something out to, don't worry about it. I'll talk to it when I get to that part of the video when I talk about the front yard. But those caladiums, doing great. Tons of growth, lots of variety. Reds and speckles and white ones, they look good. Got some nice growth on the Pakistakis lutea over here, that gold shrimp plant. Very pretty. I love the little torches of flowers they send up. Hibiscus is resting, but here's a picture. Isn't it pretty? It's one of my favorites. Wish I knew what it was called. And this is the freckles croton. The new growth is coming out with more of just like a gold dust plant appearance to it. I was a little bit bummed out about, because I mean I can just pick up one of those gold dust crotons from the hardware store for like $9. So I'm hoping that as this foliage ages, it starts to get more color to it. So you can see the lower foliage does have a little bit more color, and like way down there it's basically red. So I don't know, we will see. If it just stays like that though, then I'm not going to be as attached to that croton anymore. Gotta get pretty for me. This croton's getting a lot of sun, a lot of afternoon sun, so I might need to move it. I've always kept a croton right here in the corner, but never one this tall. So that might be, maybe it's a height thing. Maybe when I've had them down lower, because you can see the lower growth looks okay. It's everything up here. So it might need to be moved too. Now that the sun has shifted, the lighting's different out here, and it changes things, you know?
and I'm worrying that it's going to scorch when the foliage starts to get black on these guys. See that dark, dark, dark black foliage? That's as dark as it can go. That's like its last mode of defense. So if it can't stay like that, what am I trying to say? It's gonna go ahead and bleach out if that's as dark as it can go and it's not doing the trick of protecting the plant. Don't want that to happen. Gingers, not as vigorous this year. We had a very bad winter. I was concerned that they wouldn't even come back, and they have, but usually this whole area would be full. So I'm gonna up their fertilizing, I think, and get more growth coming out of them. I need to really revive those ginger rhizomes that are in the ground if I want them to survive this winter, because they're not hardy here. I'm in zone 6. Tropicana put up a flower, looking pretty. It's just being a Tropicana, not much to say about that. Yucca recurvifolias, this stump is going to go here in a few days, which I'm very excited about, and I can get this area planted up finally. Haven't seen any buds on this crinum lily, which is a little bit disappointing. Gosh, these morning glory vines. Constant. I'm constantly pulling those out. The variety is called Paracone, something like that. It has big, pretty pink flowers on it. The banana right here, it's gotten, like, really big. Much bigger than it usually gets, so I think it's kind of shading it a little bit. Now that the sun has shifted, it's starting to get more light, so I think it's fine. I like the glossy foliage. I'm going to divide it up, move some things around. That's going to look nice. The begonia adds a nice contrast there. As well as this pretty alocasia, which I think is Metallica. I asked in my last video if anyone could identify it for me, and they said it looked like a Metallica, the Plumbe Metallica, and I looked up and was like, yeah, seems about right. Really pretty, very reflective. Love, love, love those glossy, shiny leaves. And speaking of alocasias, the colocasias, the bikini teenies, they are taking over, which is what they do. I normally have sun impatiens planted up here in the front, but this year the colocasias decided they wanted to grow there. Morning. It's the next day. My memory card ran out. Hasn't happened in a long time. Switched over to 4K and forget that things take up a lot more space than they used to. So as I was saying down here, these, I need to move them. They kind of go wherever they want to. They're popping up all over the place. The variety is bikini teeny. If I hadn't said that before. And I know people were asking me it from the last garden tour where I got them from. I had to look it up. These are from Brian's Botanicals many, many, many years ago. I don't know if they still sell them. That's where I originally got them from. And here's one of the things I love about them. Look at that. Look at how the water just kind of dances on those leaves. Just so cool how it does that. And when it rains, just like with the colocasia teacups or coffee cups, the rain comes down, splatters onto those leaves, and when these get full, they tip forward, and the water pours out, and they bounce back up. It's pretty neat. Bananas back here. Oh, hold on. Look, it's like diamonds. Gorgeous. Yeah, bananas, they're doing the thing, being bananas. Getting a lot of growth out of them this year, especially considering I've been a little bit bad about fertilizing. I haven't done my, like, normal routine fertilizing. They've gotten soil amendments and some slow release, but I need to hit them with the liquid, which I'm going to be doing probably this afternoon. Going to get started on that. Doing that usually gets them to, like, explode with growth. I have a special fertilizer I use for my bananas, my colocasias, alocasias, gingers. It's specifically mostly for the palm trees, but those other plants seem to appreciate it. The Thai giants, putting out a good amount of growth. These are leucocasia gigantea, no longer colocasia. They changed it. I think it was actually originally leucocasia, and then they went to colocasia, and then they went back to leucocasia. I think that the verdict was that they had decided, the plant naming people had been like, well, it's not really an alocasia, so we're going to go with colocasia. And then after so many years, they're like, you know what? It's not really a colocasia. Leucocasia. Whatever. The Thai giant elephant ear, y'all know what I'm talking about. These, once the heat kicks in, they grow like insanity. They do lots and lots and lots of good growing when it gets hot outside. Over here, I have some things that just need to be moved. Actually, I set them where the sprinklers will get them. I want to call it overflow because it's not overflow. They're for future videos and for different parts of the garden and planters and whatnot, but they're just over here chilling where the sprinklers will get them. The Yucca ristratas are doing well. They both are putting out new growth. The one that was mostly a cutting was the one that I was, of course, the most concerned about because it didn't have any roots on it. But yeah, it's got new growth, so it's good. Now, as soon as they flush out from the top, it comes up like this and then unfurls. Once they do that, that's when I'm confident that the plant's rooted and it's doing okay. So I'm not as concerned about it anymore. That's a very good thing. And this one right here, I had already received as a rooted plant, came in a pot and everything. So that one is of course fine. I'm gonna leave the dead leaves on just because it does provide some insulation during the winter time. I'm not going to be keeping these outside in the winter just yet, but someday. I'm gonna give them a few years where every year I'll leave them out in the fall a little bit longer so they can kind of adjust to it, and then I'll pop them in the ground one day. Oleander still has a bunch of flowers on it. Really pretty. This one doesn't have a name, just was an assorted oleander. Sunflower is finishing up its flowering. I think it has one left on here, and actually, no, it's putting out a whole bunch of new buds, so that's pretty exciting. I'm not really ready for it yet, but that's all right. I'll be doing stuff with that in fall planters and not too terribly long.
Hey, Tuck. How you doing, bud? Hey, get out of there.
That's so rude. That's not for you. There's a little bit of a size reference for how big those pedicets are. We got Tucker over here sitting down. You're going to lay down? You can get up. You don't have to stay there. You're free, Tucker. You're free. Go on. You can get out. Old man, he didn't need to be sitting on the pavement, but there's a little glimpse there. There are some more gingers coming up over here. These should also be the flaming torches. I also have the Polani and Coronarium, which is just the white butterfly ginger, planted out here. But the Polani didn't make it through the winter, which is unfortunate because I've had it for a very long time. And the Coronarium is just, it just looks just like these. There are some, I almost forgot, up here amongst the nut sedge that's growing in here with my dune grass pineapple lily putting up. Would you please behave? Camera's like, there's too many colors. What do I do? Flowers coming up there on that pineapple lily. When nut sedge grows inside of the ornamental grass, it is such a nightmare to get rid of. I've been trying to stay on top of it. It's actually been a lot better this year. And then these are the flowers on the bicolor euchemis, the bicolor pineapple lily. The bananas grew so much faster than these this year that these are getting kind of shaded, so I might need to move these. It's probably time. I've had these in the ground for, I don't know, many years, so it's time to probably divide them up anyways and move them where they'll get some more sun. But they're great plants. They just flower and flower. Well, they hold on to their flowers for a long time, I should say. They put up their blooms, and those usually last 6 to 8 weeks normally. Okay, I'm going to the front yard real quick. Not much to say about the front. Hey, bud, you can't come. You're naked. You gotta have your collar on. Sometimes they get little heat rashes around their necks from their collars during the summer, so they don't have those on right now. I got a lot of the weeds pulled out of the cactus garden over here, which is something I dread doing, so that looks a lot better. The pachysandra, it's a bit much for this area, but it does so well. Nothing else grows over here in this corner, so I just leave it because it's one of the few things that does well. And over here is the berm with the dragon's wing begonias, those alocasia luteas, and then the strawberry vanilla hydrangeas. There's a lot of new growth on the alocasias, which is nice because remember they were just tiny little things when I threw them in the ground. The begonias are kind of starting to do their thing. There was just so much rain this year in June that they sort of just sat still and endured it, and which is good because a lot of plants died. Not mine, but a lot of people like their petunias and some of their begonias just drowned. And they are putting on a decent amount of growth. They're filling out fairly well. That's going to look pretty neat here, not too long. Flowers on the strawberry vanilla. Not very exciting this year because I had someone who was helping me do yard work and I handed them my hedge trimmers and they took the tops off the hydrangeas, so not probably going to get the flower show I was hoping for this year, but there is still time. We will see. I've had them do second rounds of blooms before, but it's not likely to happen unless there's a pretty long growing season. It's unfortunate. It is what it is. It happened. This would have been so pretty, though, if these had actually been covered in their flowers and like that fountain of the pink and cream. Oh, well. Not a ton to update with on the rest of the front yard. The impatiens are doing their thing, being impatiens. It's really only been a few weeks since last update with these guys, so this is where I'm thinking about maybe putting the rest of those caladiums somewhere back there. Just have to kind of wait and see. You can see, though, in the vlog when I planted these up, I had been deciding whether or not to leave all of the little seedlings in here, and I left them, and they're growing. They're doing really well. Even some of them you can see under that rhododendron there are starting to bloom, even though they're super teeny tiny.
There's some white ones back there with a red center on them. I didn't plant any of those last year. I've never planted any, I don't think, that looked like that. So maybe they like hybridized between themselves. I don't know. But lots of little babies coming up in here. So, but yeah, there's not a ton to update with because not much has happened. It's only been a couple weeks. So waiting on that stump to get ground out. I had thought I was going to wait to release this video until after that got done. But then I was like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all because it's still just going to be a giant hole there. I'm not going to have time to plant this up. So that'll hopefully be gone by the next garden tour. Well, it will definitely be gone. But I mean, hopefully this whole area will be planted up. Front porch pots are looking good. Everything's done. A lot of growing. The bananas are very full and very, very happy in there. Alocasia frydeck doing well also. The sun impatient, even though it's one of the compact ones, very vigorous, like extremely vigorous, just to be expected. That's nothing wrong with that. You can see the spider plants, they've taken very well to being divided and put in here. Those chlorophytums, I know it's dumb and probably doesn't matter to anyone, but I always prefer the chlorophytums that have the orange on them. I don't know why, just my preference. I do know why, because it adds contrast and it's very pretty. The more light they get, the more intense that orange gets. This frydeck is getting, I think, too much light. I didn't know what to do up here. My front porch has always been very shady because there was a giant Japanese maple shading it, and this year, not the case. Lots and lots and lots of sun, and things are doing well with it. I do need to, I think, maybe rehang these baskets so that the bacopa is facing outward. I didn't really pay any attention to that when I hung them up. These just go all the way up to the ceiling there. I think they need a little bit more light because, see, they're not flowering. And the creeping Jenny can take the shade, so they don't need all that sun. So I'll probably go ahead and rotate those. I think they'd look a lot better if I did. These got planted up in a vlog also, or actually they got their own video and doing well. Lots and lots of new growth. They're on drip. That's why that line's there. I like to keep them on drip just because that way, well, I don't have to remember to come out to my front yard and water them. Yeah, you can see even these bacopa, the ones that are getting a little bit more sun, they're blooming. But this, what is that? That Iconia begonia is kind of choking it out a little bit. So they need some pruning and some reshaping. But either way, they're very pretty and I'm okay with it. I really enjoy the different colors, the color combination in there. Yeah, I'm back, Tobes. You didn't think I was gonna leave you, did you? You good boy. Oh, hello. Dogs are so fantastic. They're always so happy. Who doesn't love being welcomed like that? Right, Tuck? Right, Tuck? Yeah, good boy. All right, and then some quick succulent updates. My variegated aloe here, doing well. This is a clam planter that I did in a video, I want to say back in May. I've had to keep my succulents under this table over here just because, like I've mentioned multiple times, it has just been raining and raining and raining. So some of them are a little bit stretched out from the shade. It's been a little bit too shady for them. It was the only thing I could think of to keep them dry. And it's doing well. I just think it's ready to be moved out to get some more light. And like, I have these over here hanging up from the umbrella, and they've been doing better. They're not stretching as much, which I attribute to them getting more light. And I didn't make these. I bought these. They were really cheap. I can't remember where I got them from. But when I bought them, it was with the intention of thinking, oh, I'll tear these apart and use them for other planters. And then I got kind of attached to them, and, well, I didn't. Because, you know, look, they're really pretty. All right, that's gonna do it though. That's everything. And I only have 3 minutes left on my memory card now, so gotta wrap things up. I hope everyone's doing well. There will be another tour here in just under a month. I like to get them out before the end of the, or like at the start of the month. Excited to see all the changes and progress and all the fun things happening and just watching the plants grow. So much fun. Can I show you what the wind did to this queen palm? It just like has completely pushed it. Not much I can do about that at this point, unfortunately. Well, I hope everybody's doing well, having a great day, great life, and everything's just going wonderfully for you. I have all my social media linked down below. You can follow me there. I'm on Instagram like way more than anything else. And don't forget to like the video. It makes a big difference for the channel and for the videos. I really do appreciate it. Thank you for doing that. And subscribe as well. And don't forget to hit that notification bell because I upload multiple times a week. That way you'll know when new videos come out. Okay, down to 1 minute. Hope everyone's doing well. Comment down below. Say hi, as always. And most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye bye.